In this first session, we're going to give you a little introduction to MinIO, including some ideas why you might want to pick MinIO as your data storage layer as you begin to develop your own custom applications. Let's start off by looking at some of the core concepts around MinIO storage. One of the biggest concepts that we're going to need to discuss is this idea of objects and object storage, because that's really what MinIO is giving you. An object is a binary large object for our purposes. Now, there's lots of different ways you can define object. If you're dealing with Java, you may be thinking about a Java object or something along those lines. Maybe you do a lot of object-oriented programming. But for the purposes of MinIO, an object is a blob, a binary large object. Now, this blob can be really anything. You could think of the contents of your local system. Maybe you've got some documents, you've got photos, you've got music files, videos, all kinds of different stuff. Each of those can be a blob because blobs can have any size, any format, any structure. They can be of any type. All you're doing with MinIO is uploading those blobs. They don't have to depend on a specific hierarchy for access or availability. You basically upload it, and if your user has the right access, you can download it or work with it. Individual blobs are going to have some metadata associated with it that can have all sorts of information about the context of the object, and that metadata is stored with the object. As a computer user, you're already using objects all the time. Your documents, your songs, anything that you interact with and manipulate on your computer is a binary large object. That could be photos, it could be documents, it could be intermediate data from AI or machine learning pipelines. I know that's a big jump from working with documents on your own system, but this is the sort of thing that you're going to be working with, generally speaking. You may also be working with streaming or time series data from metrics or Internet of Things devices or sensors. And you can even be working with backups from applications or dedicated software backups. All of those things can be blobs and therefore can be stored in a MinIO bucket. So what is a bucket? A bucket is where you store your blobs, basically. It's a collection of related objects and policies and configurations. It's similar to a volume in many ways. So you can be thinking of how you've mounted a certain database or you've mounted an NFS mount. All of these different file systems that you may be working with, if you are a system administrator, you can think of that as a volume. Now, as a developer on my system, I have one big volume. It's the hard drive on my system. That is my bucket. Amazon, when you're using Amazon S3 storage, limits you to basically 100 buckets per account. And each of these buckets has a globally unique DNS. And that's going to be important in just a minute. MinIO implements that same thing, but you do not have bucket limits. That said, your buckets are still like volumes, individual drives. Now, as an application developer, you're probably not going to be creating volumes yourself. You're probably just going to be consuming them. Most applications that interact with MinIO do not create their own volumes. They just use volumes that are already there. Your object storage administrator will create a bucket with all of the different features that are required for your application to use. So as an app developer, you probably don't need to worry about creating a bucket or doing the settings on the bucket or anything along those lines. You're just going to use what's been given to you. Your applications are then going to interact with these buckets to do a put and a get. There's no constraint on the hierarchy or storage of access within a given bucket. You can store your objects in whichever way you want. Again, that bucket with the put and get, you do that through that globally unique DNS. So it makes it very easy for you to read and write blobs from a given bucket. So we've talked about objects and buckets. What is object storage? Well, object storage supports flexible namespaces. That's our buckets, and again, that's our DNS, which store data in any arbitrary hierarchy from very flat, by which we mean no prefixes, to deeply nested, which means many prefixes. We're not going to talk about prefixes in a lot of detail yet. We'll talk about prefixes a little bit more later on in the course. But at this stage, you can think of a prefix as basically a directory in your volume. Your objects will consist of that unique ID some data, and then the full metadata without having to rely on an external application or middleware or anything else. Your object is a full atomic piece of data that you can work with in any way you like. You don't need to bring in any other additional software in order to access metadata or anything like that. You have unlimited scaling of your object storage through storage pools, which means that you can store just a few terabytes if you need to. You can store exabytes worth of data and anything in between. This allows you to have the ability to scale up the amount of storage you need. In many cases, once your application begins to mature, you're going to need more object storage, and you can do that very easily through MinIO. All of this object storage is easily accessible via HTTP-based RESTful APIs. That means that it doesn't matter what platform you're coming from, you can send and retrieve data as easily as doing a put or a get through an HTTP REST API. That means also that it really doesn't matter at the end of the day what language you're using to access the data. You could be using C++, or you could be using Java, or you could be using Ada. As long as you've got something that can speak to HTTP, you can access your data. With a cloud-native design that MinIO implements, you can deploy to any infrastructure. So you can deploy bare metal on your local system, and you can go all the way up through orchestrated management methods, maybe using Ansible, using Kubernetes. You can deploy it to the cloud, or you can deploy it to a local data center. It is very much integrated with this idea of being able to deploy it anywhere. Let's take it one step further and ask the question, what is S3 compatible object storage? So we've discussed what object storage is. Now we're talking about S3 compatibility. AWS S3 is a RESTful object storage service. So everything we talked about in the last slide, AWS S3 is implementing. You get a single API for any S3 compatible service that gives you portability across your applications. If you're changing your application storage layer and you're no longer going to be using real S3, if you want to just use something that's S3 compatible, that means you don't really have to change all of your code. You can literally just pick up your application and move it to a different service whenever you want. This also allows you to have multi-cloud deployments. So you don't have to be working with a single cloud. You can work on whatever cloud platform provider you happen to like, whether it's Amazon or Google, or whether you're working with Azure, or you're working with something like DigitalOcean. All of these are supported and usable with an S3 compatible object storage. That said, not all object storage services are S3 compatible, and in many cases, they only provide some partial compatibility. And the reason for this is that S3 is not open source. And in order to be S3 compatible, you have to do your own testing and reverse engineering to ensure that level of compatibility. So why is having S3 compatibility important? Well, again, that having the single API, the portability, being able to deploy to whatever cloud you want, you're not only able to use AWS S3. If you have S3 compatibility, you can really deploy it anywhere. S3 is a very common integration these days. So many software providers have an S3 compatibility layer as part of their service offering. For example, the Elastic stack actually has S3 compatibility built into the back end. Spark has S3 compatibility. Basically, any major service that's working with a lot of data is going to have S3 compatibility at this point. And the reason for this is you need to have that scalable data layer if you're going to be storing tons and tons of data. Your S3 compatible object storage then becomes this central resource, not only for whatever application you're writing, but for an entire ecosystem of applications that your company may be using. So the data that your custom application that you're going to be writing, if that's indeed your goal, the data that you're going to access is likely in S3 already, or it soon will, because of all these different tools that now have S3 compatible object storage as this resource to their system. So let's say I'm storing a bunch of data through Kafka. I'm using Kafka as a data ingest pipeline, perhaps. And that Kafka tool is now dropping the end results into S3 for its persistent storage. If I want to use that data for whatever application I'm building, it makes it much more handy if I'm able to write an S3 compatible application as well.